So let me just say a little bit. So this is joint work with Tyler. Let me just tell you a little bit what we're doing in this paper. So this is a paper in which we are going to look at a set of financial crises, roughly around 45 financial crises. And what we're trying to do is establish some common patterns. So since the US financial crisis, Doug said this, we don't really know clearly what happens in a crisis. So for example, there's been lots of debate as to whether or not the slow recovery that we've had from the US is a common pattern across financial crisis, or is it special to what happened in the US in 2008? We don't really know. And part of the reason we don't know is because a lot of research that we do in macro and finance focuses on post-war US data. And in post-war US data, there's only really one financial crisis, which is the recent one. So what we're going to do in this paper is we're going to follow some work that has been done by historians, Reinhard Rogoff, Shalarik and Taylor, others, which is to look at a larger sample that goes across countries and goes back historically, especially into the 1800s, where there's a period from 1850 to 1910, where the world is kind of full of financial crises. So we're going to construct a large sample and look at financial crisis in that way. So that what we're going to do in this paper is largely a description of data for a fairly large set of financial crises, in which what we're trying to come out with are a set of facts, that stylized facts that we understand to be true across many crises. And the novelty of this paper is that we bring in credit spreads. So if I'm sure many of you know the influential work of Reinhard and Rogoff, what they do, and I'd say most of what the people in this literature have done so far, is to look just at quantities. So you look at GDP growth, you correlate GDP growth with things like credit growth or the government debt to GDP ratio, and you'll try to understand things that way. The main novelty of what we've done is we've taken, so think of Reinhard Rogoff's data set and imagine that you have credit spreads on top of it. With credit spreads, we're going to be able to say some more stuff. So what I'm going to show you is a set of facts that emerge that come out of seeing what happens with credit spreads. And I don't think the facts that I'm going to show you are known. So they're all sort of new patterns that we have figured out. But as I said, basically what I'm going to present in this paper is just a set of, I think, what we think of as interesting, robust facts. Okay, so here are the three main facts that I'm going to present. The first one is just about what happens in the aftermath of the crisis. So this is the question that many people have been very interested in, which is the US recovery, the slow recovery, a common pattern, or is it something specific to what happened in the US recently, the zero lower bound, for example. And I'm going to show you some numbers from what we're doing. I'll give you some estimates as to what the recovery path we have seen historically across financial crises. I'll compare that to non-financial recessions so one can understand to what extent recovery paths after crises are different than recovery paths generally after just bad times or bad shocks. And with credit spreads, I think I'm going to be able to provide sharper estimates than what most people in the literature so far have done. Okay, so that's result one that I want to talk you through. Result two is I'm going to show you that suppose you're in a crisis, right? This is not about forecasting whether a crisis will happen or not, but suppose you're in a crisis and you're observing the evolution of the crisis. So we have about 45 financial crises in our sample. So we have a cross-section. And if you look in this cross-section, you have crises with differing severity. And I'll show you that you can explain the severity of financial crises with fairly well with two variables. One is the rise in spreads in the first year of the crisis. And I'm going to argue that that captures something like credit losses sitting on the financial sector balance sheets. I'll try to make this point more clear. And the extent of credit growth pre-crisis, which I'm going to argue is something like the leverage of the financial sector. Those two variables do a fairly good job of summarizing what happens in subsequently in the path of output after a crisis. And I'll try to link that to theoretical models as I go through. And then the last question, last result of this paper is going to be, I'm going to show you some evidence that spreads pre-crisis, so before the crisis starts, are in some sense abnormally low. I'll be more precise on what abnormal means, but I'm going to show you that spreads look unusually low. And this fits in with this narrative that I think has emerged from a lot of people commenting on what's happening in the world, which is, in some sense, froth precedes a crisis. I'll show you empirically. We have lots of crises, so one doesn't have to just look at the 2008 to say this. It seems like this is true, okay? All right, so the data that we have is that we're really bringing in here is credit spreads. I'll say a little bit more about this. We have credit spreads across 14 countries over this period from 1869 to 1929. It comes from old newspapers. So this is what the old newspapers look like. So when Tyler went to Yale, he discovered this data set, which is a sampling of bonds traded in the London Stock Exchange over this period. We can sample this stuff monthly. We have a lot of bonds across lots of countries. And what we have done with these bonds is we have enough information about the bonds specifically to compute yields on these bonds. And we have gone through for each country in our sample and constructed something like a yield spread, a high-grade versus low-grade yield spread. And the way we've done this is we've taken the bonds for each country, we've defined a spread as the highest 10th percentile yields versus the lowest 10th percentile yields. Okay, so we've constructed a credit spread that way across countries. That takes us to 1929. From 1930 to the present, we have pulled in from various data sources credit spreads. Okay, and this looks more standard. In some cases, we've used a high-grade minus low-grade corporate spread. In other cases, we've used a corporate bond index to a government bond index. Okay, so we have collected credit spreads across a whole bunch of countries now. Now, one thing that you'll immediately realize as I've talked through this is that the credit quality of the spreads in these different countries is different. In some cases, we have something like a AAA, BBB spread. In other cases, maybe we have something like a CCC to government bond spread. So the credit quality is different. And we're going to use spreads as a signal about the world. And it's important to find a way to normalize these spreads. That is, you want the underlying information to be the same. So we've played with a bunch of different normalizations. The one I'm going to show you is, for each country, we'll take the spread and just divide it by the average spread for that country. So this is roughly like saying, suppose in the US you had a triple C treasury spread. We would take the time variation, that triple C treasury spread, and just represent it as deviation from the average. Okay, and that doing that across all countries gives us a sample that looks fairly consistent when we compare across countries. Okay. So we have a total of 900 country-year observations as a result of this. All right, so that's credit spreads. What we will then do is, I will say a little bit more about this, we'll cross this credit spread data with crises dates. So there's historians who have examined the sample that we have and identified events that look like financial crises, events that look like major bank failures. And so we're going to pick out those dates that other people have pulled out as being relevant, a relevant chronology of crises. This is going to be quite important, so I'll come back and talk a little bit more about this. So across, we have three set of datings from different historians. Across these different datings, this is the representation of financial crises. And then last, we have GDP data. We're using the Barrow-Ursua GDP data, which is sort of a constructed GDP data because GDP data is not collected systematically by governments for much of the sample over this period. Okay, so that's the data. The empirical approach here is going to be the following. We're going to be interested in asking questions like, how does GDP behave around a financial crisis? So to do this to measure this, you have to focus on what is a crisis. That is, what we're going to be doing is we're going to pick a set of events, call them financial crises. We're going to be examining GDP around these events, and then we'll compare how GDP is behaving around those events to how GDP is behaving around another set of events, for example, a recession or non-crises. So it's going to be critical for us to define these events properly. That is, we're interested in how things behave around a set of events that are called crises, and it's the choice of dates is going to be centrally important, right? Because that's really, in some ways, it's going to drive all of your conclusions. So let me say a little bit about then what is a financial crisis. So theoretically, I think we have a fairly good idea. There's been a bunch of theoretical work on trying to model the dynamics of financial crises, and I'm trying to summarize across all of this work what comes out, and my sense is this is basically it. So if you were to kind of in reduced form talk about a whole collection of crisis models, they all have the following flavor. There's a slow-moving variable, some sort of state variable, which is fragility, right? In many models, this is the equity capitalization of the financial sector, or maybe it's the leverage of the financial sector. It's a slow-moving variable. And you have a shock, losses, typically is the shock. And the interaction of the fragility, a slow-moving fragility variable with a shock, losses, creates a financial crisis, okay? So the shock is a trigger, you know, housing prices fall, and the amplification mechanism is, say, leverage, right? So if you interact those two things, you get a crisis. What are the characteristics of a crisis? Well, you get an asset price feedback, fire sales, illiquidity, et cetera. So you have an asset price feedback. You have the financial sector stepping back, so you get a credit crunch. So lending is constrained. You have bank runs, failures, and disintermediation. So this is one set of characteristics that we think are associated with financial crises. And importantly, for what we're going to be doing, credit spreads rise. For fairly obvious reasons, expected default has gone up, hitting a crisis. And then risk and liquidity premia also rise, which are a component of credit spreads. So credit spreads will rise. Right, so lots of papers about this, but this is just to summarize how one should think about a crisis as we go through. Okay, so with that, let me go to the first main result that I want to talk through. And this is this question of what you should have expected standing in 2008. What should you have expected about the path of output going forward? Right, so we've seen this very slow recovery. What should you have expected in 2008? So the answer that much of the literature has put out, and I think Reinhardt and Rogoff are probably the most influential paper on this. So in their paper, which is titled "The Aftermath of a Crisis," what they tell us is that you should expect a deep recession and a slow recovery. And that's what they have told us. The way they come to this conclusion is they select a set of events that they call financial crises. So this is just pulling a picture from their paper. They take a set of events and they take an average. This is the average contraction in the financial crisis. This is the average duration of the contraction. So they compute an average and they say, look, based on these averages, it looks like in these events we have deep contractions and slow recoveries. Now, that's fine. A set of issues, though, that immediately emerges when you look at a computation like this is you worry that your answer is very dependent on what you call a financial crisis. Right? So if I was to draw the threshold for what I'm going to call a financial crisis right here and throw all these events away and call these events crises, I'm going to get a very different answer than if I was to average all of these numbers. Right? So there's just a basic worry that your answer is very dependent on what you define as a crisis event. And really, the deeper problem that's driving this is that the approach that much of the literature has taken is they've defined crises and non-crises, a 0-1 classification, and then have averaged things across the set of dates that they've called crises. When in fact, there is a wide variety of financial crises with varying severity. And so if you're interested in the answer to the question of what should you have explained about 2008, one should be thinking, you know, what events are the relevant benchmarks for thinking about 2008? The Depression, presumably more, and, you know, the 1980s SNL crisis, probably less, right? So somehow that information needs to be brought to bear in figuring out this question as to what one should expect after a financial crisis. And so with that, this is really the first reason why credit spreads are useful. Credit spreads are a continuous measure of the severity of a financial crisis. So the literature has used this 0-1 classification, crisis or not, take an average as a crisis. We have credit spreads. So credit spreads are useful because they allow us to distinguish among the severity of the crisis. So for example, in the 1980s SNL crisis, spreads rise, but they don't rise that much. So it's a mild crisis. In in the 1929 depression, spreads rise a lot, a much more severe crisis. So with this information, we are able to say a little bit more, provide a sharper statement to what should happen in the aftermath of the crisis, because we can more precisely define what crisis is relevant for thinking about 2008. Right? So empirically, this is what we do. If you think about spreads, spreads will reflect, on a forward-looking basis, default risk. Right? If output is expected to be low, you're going to expect more default. If output is expected to be low, risk premia attached to those states are probably also high, so you should expect higher risk premia. And a characteristic of financial crises is liquidity problems, so you'd expect that spreads rise because of illiquidity issues. All of these parts of the spread are going to be should be increasing in the severity of a financial crisis. So suppose one thought that the kind of underlying relation between output growth after a crisis and the severity of a crisis is just linear in the severity of the crisis. So Z, if you remember from my terminology before, was the shock in a crisis. F was fragility. Say, this is my reduced form theory. The product of this is the severity of a crisis. One would expect a relation like this. You're really interested in this beta coefficient, how the severity of a crisis affects output, which is what beta does. Most of the current literature has basically said, drop beta and just run this regression on a dummy, which is a crisis. So we provide a slightly sharper estimate by having a measure of the severity of a crisis. So these are regressions we're going to run. More precisely, what we're going to do is we're going to run panel data regressions, country is I, the horizon is K, output growth over the next K periods against a country dummy, a time dummy, and then a set of dummies for whether an event is a crisis or not a crisis, again, as defined by the current literature, interacted with spreads in the crisis and outside a crisis, and a set of controls. The controls here are lag GDP growth, and I'll come back and talk more about this, the three-year credit growth from Shilarek and Taylor, which is known to be a predictor of a crisis. Right? So what we're going to be interested in asking, how do these coefficients here compare to these coefficients here? How is it that in a crisis, spreads are systematically related to output growth versus outside of a crisis? That's basically what we're going to be doing. Now, you might ask yourself, why do you still use 0-1 crisis dummies? Why use dummies at all? Why not just run a basic regression of spreads on output growth, which, for example, lots of people in the forecasting literature do? So why bring in the crisis information as well? So we still do, and the reason we do this is because the crisis dummies that historians have identified are associated with events that have to do with disruption of the financial sector. And it's useful information, because what we're interested in understanding is how output behaves after a disruption, a financial disruption. What we're doing is we're really saying, if you have a financial disruption and you can measure severity in the disruption using spreads, we can identify off the cross section, which is off of how different severity there is in different crises, to learn something about output growth. That's really what we're doing. But we're not throwing away the dummy information at all. So it's still important to use the dummies. And so just to give you an example, you know, suppose spreads rise because we're going into a war. It has nothing to do with a financial disruption. You might expect some relation between spreads and output, say, over this war, but that's not going to tell you particularly about how output grows in a financial crisis. You'd be much more interested in asking, how do spreads and output relate in a crisis event in which there is a financial disruption? So our basic specification says, take a set of dates that other people have identified to be a financial crisis and run a regression of those dates on spreads as a measure of the severity of a financial crisis. Right, so that's what we're going to do. The set of dates, there's a couple sets of dates which we're going to use. This is most of the results I'm going to highlight are coming from this set of dates. So Shilarek and Taylor and Jordan Shilarek and Taylor look across the sample that we look at and define financial crises. They define crises as events in which the country's banking sector experiences bank runs, high default rates, losses of capital. Okay, so what looks like a financial crisis? So they look across the historical record and pull out a set of events that look like financial crises. Now, you can see immediately, and this is why spreads are useful, you get worried when you see a description like this, that this is very qualitative. What is the threshold one is using for saying losses of capital? Is it big? Is it small? And that's going to affect what you what you come out. But what the spread does for us is it essentially downweights observations in which losses in capital are small and upweights information in which losses in capital are high. That's really what the spreads do. Right, so this is one set of events which we're going to focus on. Now, Shalark and Taylor date the event, and this is going to be important for interpreting some of the results, based upon the start of the recession accompanying the crisis. Okay, so in many crisis episodes, you see an event which is bank failure. The event is very often after the start of the recession that accompanies the financial crisis. So what Shalark and Taylor do is they date the recession date, which is at the start. And I think it's interesting and important to focus on that date, because in many cases, a disruption in the financial sector doesn't happen after you get bankruptcy. It happens before, for example, via a reduction in loan supply. So what they do is they date the recession that starts the crisis. And that's also going to be a useful set of dates, because we can compare that very directly to non-financial recession dates. Which will give you a sort of an apples-to-apples comparison as to what happens to output in a recession that has a crisis and a recession that doesn't have a crisis. Okay, so this is one set of dates. The other two sets of dates are the Reinhardt-Rogoff dates and a set of dates from Bordeaux and co-authors. The definitions of these dates of what they call a crisis, if you read the words, you'll say, this looks awfully a lot like how Shalark and Taylor have defined it, and they are, but you'll notice there's 48 crises here, 27 crises here, 44 crises here. So lots of people have looked at the same record and come up with different numbers on what are crises. In fact, the overlap, if you just run a regression of the crisis event dates across these three chronologies, the correlations are varying from 25% to 65%. So people don't quite agree, and it affects results, because what you call a crisis and what you don't call a crisis ends up mattering for what you conclude about what should happen to output after a crisis. All right, so this is that regression on the set of spreads with crisis dummies. These are spreads on a dummy with the Shalark and Taylor crises, and I said all these regressions have country-fixed effects as well as year-fixed effects. That's the coefficient I want you to focus on. I'm going to provide you a visual as to what this means. This is three-year GDP growth when a crisis or a recession starts at time t. So 3 years from now, what does output grow over the next 3 years? You want to compare that coefficient to another set of coefficients that come from interacting spreads with other crisis dates. So this is the Reinhardt-Rogoff set of crisis dates. This is the Bordeaux-Eichengreen set of crisis dates. These coefficients are different. To a large extent, this difference is are due to the fact that these guys are dating at the beginning of the recession, whereas this is dating at the event date. So we'll have to come back and decide which event dates we care more about. My feeling at present, and I'll try to argue to this more thoroughly, is that this is the right set of event dates. You want to look at the start of a recession, not the crisis event. And you can see it matters, because you get different output paths depending upon where you date. You want to compare the Shalark and Taylor crisis date regression most closely to what you have with recession, and that differences in the coefficient tell you something about output going forward. I'll make this visually in a second. Parentheses standard error, so all of this stuff is quite significant. Just to show you what is driving our regressions, just look at the bottom panel here. This is three-year GDP growth in the crisis events. Plotted against the predicted values, the fitted values from the regression. You can see here, it's a big scatter. The depression dates are quite important. But you can drop the depression, and this is the scatter if you don't. So this is just blowing up this cloud here. And you see a fairly good relation. So that's to say, and if you just run a very simple regression, which is just pick the dates of the financial crisis and ask, how does three-year output growth correlate with credit spreads? The answer is the R squared is close to 50%. So credit spreads in the first year of a financial crisis do a fairly good job of sorting among the severity of what happens to output going forward. And that's important, because that's going to be our measure of differences across crises. All right, so I'm going to show you visually these differences, a comparison of what happens to output in a crisis compared to another event. And what we're going to do is just plot effectively an impulse response. So suppose I look at the cross-section, I take spreads and I increase them by one. Why one? One is roughly the standard deviation, the one sigma of the spreads. It's, remember, we've normalized spreads by the mean spread, so there isn't the interpretation here isn't 100 basis points, it's one, right? It's like doubling the spread. And I'll compare the output path to that event minus the output path if spreads didn't go up by one. Okay, so that's going to tell me what happens to output after a crisis. You can give this a structural interpretation, what I'm going to show you. It's the structural interpretation was, imagine there's some shock Z that's the same in two economies. In one economy, you have a levered financial sector, so you observe output associated with the financial crisis. In another one, you have a non-levered financial sector, and you observe output going forward. That you'd be interested in asking how different those output paths are. That'll tell you what a given shock does in two economies, one in which you have a crisis and one in which you haven't. We're trying to mimic that. It's not quite, because the shock here is one. So you have to ask, why is that shock one, and is that the same shock across these two sets of dates? The answer is they aren't. Almost surely they're not. Although for interpreting these numbers, it's very likely that the shock associated with the recession that gets you the same move in spreads is a much bigger shock than the shock in a crisis that gets you the same move in spreads. Right, that is just, if you just think about how much of a shock would you need to the economy in order to get a 100 basis point move in spreads, well, in a crisis, you would need a very small shock. Why? Because risk premium rise, liquidity premium rise, you're going to get a much bigger amplifier, so a small shock will get you a big effect. In a recession, it's probably less likely to be true. Okay, so my priors are that that the numbers I'm going to show you are biased towards reducing the output path in a crisis and raising the ones in a recession. All right, so here's the impulse response. This is the Shalark and Taylor crisis dates. This is the path of output. And again, this is what we're plotting here. This is the path of output in a recession. So that is that difference for us is what we think of as the crisis effect. So I look at that and I say, Reinhardt and Rogoff are right. The path of output in a crisis is much worse than the path of output in a recession. And we have some numbers on how different this is.
Yeah. This is just raw spread split across those dates, or this is from that first regression that has the dummy?
This is from this regression,
yeah.
In which what we're doing is we're just shocking this spread by 100 basis points by one, yeah. And then we're plotting output path going forward. Okay, so it's closest to a VAR where you shock. We're not doing quite a VAR. We're doing something similar. All right. So really, what this graph is it's playing off the difference in coefficients of spreads interacted with crises and spreads interacted with recessions. That's really what this graph is representing. Right, so it's telling you that a given spread rise gets you a worse output response in a crisis than it does in a non-crisis. Here is the 2008 event. So I can do the same thing. I can condition on the spread in 2008, and I can plot the fitted value of what one should have expected to output going forward in 2008. So this is the predicted path in dashed line. Here's the actual path. So the predicted path is actually more a slower recovery than the actual slow recovery that we've had. So I walk away from this thing saying, yes, it is true. The experience of 2008 is representative. In fact, it's representative in the other direction. We've had a faster recovery than one would have expected based upon historical financial crises. Here's the path of spreads. This is also interesting. You see that spreads in the recent financial crises come down much more quickly than output. That difference is also interesting because it tells you something about maybe how risk premium and liquidity premium have evolved in this event relative to the average event. The financial sector, in some sense, fixed itself fairly quickly compared to past events. I'm not going to say too much about this, but one could argue that this difference here, which is the correlated errors in the spread path and the output path, tell you that, in fact, we've done better. Right, we've recovered from the crisis quicker. We have both in terms of output as well as in terms of spreads than we have based upon a historical difference. And the note there is that this average, this regression I'm running is from a sample that includes periods in which you have no central bank. All right, so lots of 1800s in here. All right, so that's the 2008. Now, here, this is the path of output using the Shalarik and Taylor dates, and this is the path of output using the Reinhardt-Rogoff dates. You know, you get significant declines in output in both of these events, but the Reinhardt-Rogoff results are actually much more muted compared to Shalarik and Taylor. In fact, it's kind of amazing when I started looking at these numbers, Reinhardt and Rogoff are the ones who have told us that you should expect a slow recovery, but their dates actually lead you to a much slower recovery than what another set of dates are. I think the primary difference is because of dating. They're dating based upon the event in which the banks fail rather than the start of the recession. And that difference in dating account for a substantial difference in output. So let me just summarize here. I think our conclusion from this first set of facts is the historical record tells us big declines in crises, smaller declines in recessions. You might be worried about two things. One, I've already pointed out, there are these differences that depend on dates. So you kind of worry, which dates should we use? I've already flagged for you the difference is really about when you date the failures versus the start of a recession. So I'm going to say more about that. And then there is a worry that floats around the literature. There's a paper by the Romers who have made this point very clear, which is you're very worried about peak ahead bias, right? That is, we're defining output paths based upon crises events. So you get worried that the events that we've defined as a crises are events that lead to bad output realizations, right? So once you've done that, you're worried about a bias that's affecting all of these numbers. So keep that in mind as well. All right, so here's the second result. I think all of the theories, as I've kind of drawn a line through a collection of theories, tell us that crisis severity should be measured by something about losses and something about fragility. The product of those two should tell you something about the severity of the crisis. In most models, Z is losses on bank assets and FT is leverage. Okay, so keep that in mind and let me show you some other stuff. And so if you look at this regression that I showed you before, I had highlighted before what spreads were doing in the crisis. Right? The spread in the crisis tells you something about output path. Now you will notice in all of these, especially the Shalarik and Taylor regression, the lagged crisis also is quite important. In fact, if you look at that, it looks roughly like it's the change in spreads that really matters, not the level of the spreads. This is not an obvious result in the sense that, you know, you normally would expect that the level of the spread, because it's the most recent information, should summarize everything about the future. Why would the lag spread particularly matter? And in fact, if you look at recessions, the same regressions that I'm running on recessions, lag spreads have very little explanatory power. It's all in the current level, right? You have variants of this when you look at Reinhardt-Rogoff and Bordeaux-Eichengreen. The lag spread turns out to be somewhat important, but not that statistically significant, not nearly as much as the Shalarik and Taylor crisis dates. Our interpretation of this is that changes in spreads are very correlated with losses, right? Banks are sitting on credit-sensitive assets, and if the trigger in a crisis is losses, the change in spreads is going to reflect losses quite well. While the level of spread might tell you something about future output growth, it's losses that are particularly important for financial crisis events, which is why the lag spreads turns out to be important for the crisis dates, but not so important for the recession dates. The fact that lag spreads turn out to be so important for crisis dates in Shalarik and Taylor and less important for these guys also leads me to think that it's the Shalarik and Taylor events that are dating correctly. So this is the other reason why I'm going to pick on Shalarik and Taylor as being probably the most relevant set of crisis dates for what we're going to show through. This is the three-year output growth. You might be worried this is specific through 3 years. Let me just show you. Same thing with the five-year output growth, and you see roughly the same effects. At five-year output growth, the lag spread turns out to be very important in the Shalarik and Taylor events. It's again very much like the difference. The difference starts to matter roughly for Reinhardt-Rogoff, but not nearly as statistically strong. For recessions, it's the level of the spread that really matters for subsequent output growth. All right, so what we kind of pulled out from this is it looks robustly like it's the difference that matters for crisis, but the levels that matter for non-crisis. All right, so if you just follow that thought a little further, let's try to look for losses, okay? So we're going to define a set of events. So with no reference to Shalarik and Taylor or Reinhardt-Rogoff, let's define events in which we'll call an event a spread crisis if the change in spreads is in the 90th percentile and the change in the dividend yield in the stock market is above median. Okay, so we're looking for events in which there are large losses, events in which the stock market falls, events in which the credit spreads really rise. Right? Let's pick a set of events in which there's losses, and let's pick pick events in which there's fragility in the financial sector. So, fragility. Ideally, one would like from theoretical models to measure something like the leverage of the financial sector. Right? If leverage is very high, if equity capital is very low, that should tell you that a given set of losses will get you a bigger impact. Across the sample that we have, it's hard to measure leverage in a systematic way. It's hard to measure equity capital for the Dutch banking sector in the year 1875 in a clear, consistent way. So we're going to do something shorthand, which we know should work, given the work of Schillard and Taylor, which is to use the three-year growth in credit prior to time t. Schillard and Taylor have told us that has strong predictive power for the event crisis. So define another dummy, which is one, if three-year credit growth is particularly high. So this is a relevant variable because it looks like this variable rises ahead of crises. And it's a variable that probably correlates with an increase in leverage and a decrease in bank capitalization. Okay, so here's here's now regressions with these events. So I've defined a set of events which have to do with losses and events that are preceded by high credit growth. If you just look at events with crises and you forecast and you just compute averages of output growth going forward, this is the path of output. So you see a fairly significant decline in output going forward. If you cross this with crisis, with big losses and credit growth preceding these big losses, you see a much more severe decline in output going forward. So if you look, for example, at the two-year point, if you're just conditioned on big losses, you see output falling about 4%. If you're conditioned on big losses and high credit growth, output's falling about 5%. If you look at the four-year point, you see a much bigger difference. Right? So the events that you pick out, which look like losses and high credit growth, get you a big decline in output. And I'm going to show you in a second, these big declines in output actually line up close, not quite, but close to what Schillard and Taylor define as losses. This is the output path. This is the Schillard and Taylor output path, this orange line. This is if you condition on these events that I've just shown you, right? The credit losses and credit growth. This is the path of output. It's not as bad as Schillard and Taylor, but this is Reinhard Rogoff and Bordeaux Eichengreen, which is up here, so it's sort of somewhere in the middle. These set of dates, this path is interesting for a couple of reasons. One, it's interesting because it kind of corresponds to what we think of theoretically as a crisis, losses and fragility. And second, it's free of the peak ahead bias problem, right? The Romers have told us, so I've just flagged for you, you know, you're worried about these crises, that you're worried that you're dating a crisis exposed. This is a set of crisis dates that I have dated based upon information prior to time t. Spreads and credit growth are all quantitative information. So you could look at the difference and you could say, and I'm not willing to say this, that this is the extent of the peak ahead bias. You could also look at this difference and say, no, you know, there's information in these event dates that we're not quite capturing in the green line. So at this point, I haven't decided which is the right interpretation. I have some ideas about sorting it out, but we haven't figured out how to sort that out. Okay. All right, this is the last result of the paper. We kind of know this from Schillard and Taylor, which is this is the path of credit growth. Okay, so the three-year growth in credit prior to a crisis grows very quickly and then comes down in a crisis. Time zero here is the date of the crisis. So Schillard and Taylor have told us, and really it's this last regression again, that has told us that lagged credit growth tells you something about the fragility of the financial sector and something about the subsequent event of a financial crisis. Now, lagged credit growth is observable, right? If we think that it's a fragility measure, it's completely observable. And you would expect that investors would condition on this when they set credit spreads. So, for example, the spread at date prior to the crisis should reflect what you expect to happen in output in a crisis and what the chances of losses are that that trigger a crisis. So the probability of an event that triggers a crisis times fragility should tell you something about credit spreads even before a crisis. And one would expect that as fragility rises, that credit spreads would rise with it. That sort of seems like a reasonable thing to think, as long as this probability remains constant. Okay. That turns out not to be true at all. I'll show this a couple different ways. So if you just run a very simple regression, you run credit spreads across our entire sample, put in a dummy for the 5 years before a financial crisis. You know, here there's country fixed effects, year fixed effects, this is lag credit growth, this is lag GDP. So try to condition on other things that are common and ask how do spreads compare before a crisis to other events that are not crises. The answer is spreads are on the order of 30% below in the run-up to a crisis. Okay, so 30% below, just remember we've normalized spreads, so this is a statement like if on average the spread is 200 basis points, then prior to a crisis spreads are 140 basis points. That's what this number means. All right, so this is one fact. I think the more interesting fact is if you then break out the covariates and you put in the credit growth by itself, as well as credit growth interacted with the dummy for a crisis is coming in the next 5 years, you'll notice that the coefficient flips sign. And moreover, once you put in this covariate, the dummy on spreads now drops to zero. So what is this telling us? It's telling us that, first of all, unconditionally, forget about crises, credit growth and changes in spreads are positively correlated. I forgot to tell you here, in this regression, lagged spreads 5 years ago is also a covariate. So unconditionally, if you see a big change in credit, if credit grows, you will find that spreads grow. That's unconditionally the case. However, if you condition on a crisis happening at year T, and you compute the correlation between spread changes and credit growth ahead of a crisis, they're negatively correlated. And so that negative correlation basically means that ahead of a crisis, it looks like credit is growing, but spreads are falling. And that fall in spreads is the reason why spreads are unusually low. Right? So it's almost like saying, if you observe on average credit growing, on average what happens is credit grows and spreads rise. And sort of investors anticipate that this means big greater fragility, and so they bid up spreads. But if you observe that credit's growing and spreads are falling, it means something else. It means that the likelihood of a crisis is now much, much higher. Here is a visual representation of this. This is the average spread across our entire sample of crisis dates, where time zero is the crisis. This is just the fitted value from those regressions. So it's trying to kind of create a fundamental spread based upon what's happening to credit growth. And you notice that ahead of the crisis, spreads look too low. That's the sense in which I mean too low. Whereas in the crisis, the spreads blow up. So again, just interpretation-wise, I think what this means is you normally would expect that as credit grows, spreads would rise. The only reason that wouldn't be true is if you also thought that the chances of some big trigger, losses, housing bubble falling, is falling at the same time. That's the only way that spreads could fall. So if I put this together, what it's telling me is that a crisis is an event in which there's a big surprise. Right, investors are not anticipating anything bad to happen. And the event of a crisis is a big shift in expectations as to what in the world is happening. So a large shift in investor expectations, it looks very much like nighty and uncertainty or neglected risk, depending upon what you want. What it doesn't look like is there are other papers that people have written, and Gary, I've put your paper here. You can comment on this later. There are papers which people have written which have this slow buildup phase, right? So if credit's growing slowly, you get a slow buildup, and then eventually built up so much that you get a crisis, this sort of deterministic cycle. That's not the world. I can say that's not the world because, for example, in this paper, you would expect that as credit is growing ahead of a crisis, as fragility is building up, spreads would be rising. And it goes the other way. So there's something important about investor expectations that are going in the other way. Bubble-like behavior, if you want, is what it looks to me like. ahead of a crisis that distinguishes the crisis from other events in which investor expectations are not falling. So I'm done here. I guess I've shown you three sets of events. The first set of results is that the aftermath of a crisis is a deep and protracted recession. These results are very consistent with a collection of papers in the literature. I would say we provide much more precise answers than people have. And really, we're coming with this precision because we're using variation in severity indexed by spreads. We're using the cross-section of crises rather than just taking simple averages across crises. The second set of event, second result I've shown you is that it looks very much like the subsequent severity of a crisis is well predicted by two variables, something that looks like losses and something that looks like amplification. I view this as vindication for a large class of theories that are basically loss amplification theories of crises. This looks quite good, and as I mentioned, the R-squares are near 50%. So with these two variables, we can say quite a lot about the aftermath of a crisis. And then the third result is this business about spreads ahead of crisis. It sure looks like spreads pre-crisis do not price an increase in fragility that's observable. So in that sense, crises look like surprises, big surprises relative to what investors' expectations are. All right, I'm done. Thank you, Doug.
Let me start by stepping back and trying to give you an overview of what we're trying to understand. And I'm going to do that by talking about one of my very old papers, 30 years paper. In this paper, I looked at the national banking era, and I was looking for a threshold event in terms of information that was what depositors would see and would cause them to run on the banks. Right? So a crisis is a different kind of event than other events. And there were, you know, lots of ideas here, seasonals, unusual seasonals, a failure of a large company, or macroeconomic news. And what I found was that it was macroeconomic news. It was an unexpected shock in an index of leading economic indicators, the liabilities of failed non-financial corporations, which was widely discussed in the financial press at the time, and Burns and Mitchell had talked quite a bit about. Now, the interesting thing about this shock was that every time it went above a threshold, a numerical value, there was a panic. There was never a panic when it didn't go above that threshold, and there was never any other event where it went above the threshold. So we knew there was this news. I knew there was this news. The size of this news was correlated with the subsequent downturn, panic date to trough. Now, I like this period, and I still work on this period, and the reason I do is that there's no central bank, and I'm going to talk about the importance of that in a minute. There's no issue of crisis dating, because if the New York Clearinghouse issued loan certificates conditioned on the information they had, they thought it was bad enough to do that. That turned out to be correct. So what's happening in this paper is we're going to go back and relook at these issues with a larger sample. We're not going to be able to go after the information directly. We're going to use the credit spread. And that does have the advantage that we have a lot more countries and a lot more crises. And as Arvind stressed, this is going to give us power from the cross-section. Now, there's costs to this. First of all, the spread is a more complicated object. And we don't really understand spreads, something I'll talk about at the very end. And as Arvind emphasized, there's trouble with the dating of crises. And I think, as I'll discuss, that's because in this period of these 14 countries, at least 10 of them had central banks, and some of them were very active in crises, like the Bank of England. So this difficulty of dating crises is really a problem. So if you look at annual data, if you look at the World Bank crisis data set of 147 systemic events since 1970, there's four sets of researchers who've classified crises, and they don't match. They use this World Bank data set. Some have crises that others don't have. They have different start dates. And there are several papers by John Boyd and co-authors that show that declines in deposits can forecast the start dates in the World Bank data set. And that's related to this idea that Arvind's going to point out, which is that Shularik and Taylor's recession dates turn out to be more important than the actual crisis dates. Now, the crisis dates, if you really probe into this stuff, you know, there's a lot going on. First of all, a lot of these people have never gone back and actually read the original material. There's some conceptual confusion about what a crisis is. And it's not as if they're all independent, right? I mean, Shularik and Taylor look at Bordeaux, and Reinhardt and Rogoff use this old book by Conant. And so it's a bit of a mess. And it is going to matter. Now, the problem is that in these crises, in the modern crises, and I suspect in Arvind's crises, what happens is you get the recession starting and you get deposits going down, but everybody waits to see what the government, the central bank, are going to do. And then they do something, and then that's in the newspapers, and that's taken as the beginning of the crisis. So it's not surprising to me that using the recession start, which is what Arvind's going to focus on, is in fact the right thing to do. Now, that has some noise too, because that dating is from the Brian Boshin algorithm, which has its own set of issues. So there's a lot of data issues here, which I didn't have, but then I only had five crises. So that's the trade-off here. Now, all right, so let me go to the first result. So the change in spreads forecasts the severity of crisis. In my work, it was the shock, the information shock, forecast the severity of the crisis. So here, it wasn't that I thought conceptually this result was going to be surprising. I just thought it was surprising because all the data is measured with noise. So I find this result very compelling, and I agree that it's power from the cross-section. Now, we don't know what this change in the spread corresponds to. Arvind wants to interpret it as information about losses, something I'll come back to. And if you just look at the spread, then there are these false positives, which are shown in figure 8. So even when you refine your definition of a spread crisis, it doesn't line up exactly. And that's, I think, because this spread is more complicated than just getting the information. And we don't know what the relevant information is in the spreads. You know, if we could decompose the spread somehow, that would be kind of interesting. And I'll say a little bit more about that in a few minutes. Now, what about beating up on Reinhardt and Rogoff? Okay, it's true this 9.3% got a lot of publicity out there in the world. I think most academics understood that there was, you know, some cross-section variation. So let me, in their defense, since they're not here, let me point out that they have a recent paper, which is not in the references, where they calculate a severity measure of these crises. And they don't run regressions, but there's a kind of an arms race here. They have 100 countries and 6,000 crises or something. And one thing, and let me show you what theirs looks like compared to Arvind and Tyler's 3-year cumulative growth. They're interested in pointing out that there are these multiple dimensions to this. And I think, and they have a very simple way of calculating this. So one thing I would recommend is that in addition to sorting out this central bank business for the countries in their sample, to look at the Reinhardt and Rogoff measure of severity, which I think has improved. So everybody's kind of improving here as the literature evolves. And this is a small paper in AER, Papers and Proceedings. Now, credit growth. Yes, most studies show that credit growth is the best predictor of crises. This was predated Shalark and Taylor, but there's 20 papers that say this by now. And this issue that came up at the end is, since the credit boom is observable, why isn't this information incorporated into the spread? And so there's a lot of complications here. One reason is, first of all, you have to have an explanation for why there's a credit boom, right? If you're going to have a model of crises, then your model needs to have a credit boom before the crisis. So you need to explain that as part of the model. So I think you know, as a matter of theory, you need to have a credit boom, and Arvind's preferred theory papers don't have this credit boom. So in thinking about this, spreads are too low, I have now a picture I'm looking at. 10-year AAA credit cards spread to LIBOR, floating rate credit cards spread to LIBOR, and it goes like this. So it's this period of flat that Arvind is saying is too low, right? And then there's some other pictures which show you the steep rise in the recent crisis of any measure of credit, mortgage, non-mortgage, total. And so too low depends on what this credit boom is about. Now, if the boom is about a shortage of safe debt, then prices are bid up on the privately produced debt and yields go down. Right? That's what I think is going on. And you think you're an investor, as I was in 2007, and I say, oh my God, these credit spreads are just ungodly low. Well, what do? You withdraw from the market. You're a price taker. You withdraw from the market. And there's this huge appetite for, you know, AAA mortgage-backed security tranches. And so that compresses the spreads, even though everybody knows that the fragility is building up. But everybody in a sense is myopic. Now, I think they can sort this out, and I think it would be worth looking into, because Arvind has already shown in work with Annette Fissing-Jorgensen that when treasuries to GDP goes down, the convenience yield goes up. And the convenience yield is a different spread, right? The convenience yield is AAA corporates minus treasury. The spreads I'm looking at are AAA floating rate credit cards to LIBOR. So that can be compressed while the other one is rising, right? So Shularak and Taylor have the sovereign debt to GDP ratio in another paper. So they have these data. So I think if we say, look, we have credit booms that end in a crisis, we have credit booms that don't end in a crisis, we have spreads over the periods where there's a credit boom that doesn't end in a crisis, we have spreads over the period of a credit boom that does end in a crisis, and we have measures of the convenience yield that was used in other papers of Arvind's, I think we can make some more progress here in terms of sorting this out. So that's my third recommendation, right? So just to review, central banks, Arvind wrote it down. Okay. Now, financial crises are different. I thought we already knew this, but I think maybe only a small number of people know this. But in this paper, there's some more specific information about this. And the specific information is that spreads and credit growth are positively correlated unconditionally, but conditional on 5 years prior to a crisis, they're negatively correlated. But what I'm interested in is, okay, what's the correlation over the period where there's a credit boom that doesn't end in a crisis? That would be an interesting number also, and that gets at this issue of what agents are expecting. Can agents distinguish between these two kinds of credit booms? And again, that's something that these guys can look at. Now finally, I think there's a question here which is not just their question, but it's a question in the whole literature. And that has to do with what the information is in the spreads. So remember, spreads have these sort of magical powers, right? Gilchrist and others have shown that spreads forecast economic activity. Philippon builds Tobin's Q from bond prices, and neoclassical investment theory works great. Colin Dufresne, Goldstein, and Martin have a paper in JF that looks in the change in corporate spreads in panel data. They put anything you can find, firm-specific, macro, on the right-hand side, and they find a common component in the residuals. And stock returns don't forecast anything. So Arvind emphasized that there's this, I mean, his view of the world is there's a shock to bank capital. That's not my view of the world. But that, if that's true, if it's a shock to bank capital, shouldn't I see the stock market go down? Shouldn't stock market crashes be coincident with this spike in credit spreads? And that's not the case. That was not the case historically. And so the stocks, you know, can't predict things that credit spreads can predict. And it's not just the predictive power. Bond prices can do all sorts of things that stock prices can't do. And that's very important because it begs, the paper and other papers sort of beg the question of what's so special about debt. And one answer, I think, is that debt can be used as collateral and equities can't. But I don't have a model that shows what you would predict from that, and I can't necessarily explain these puzzles. But I think that's something that it's a puzzle that this paper contributes to. It's another puzzle. But overall, I think it's a paper that's really gone through a lot. It's changed, and I really appreciate that, you know, the effort that went into the data. Arvind was my undergraduate research assistant 30 years ago and worked on the free banking era with me. So I'm sort of thinking now that maybe some of that rubbed off. Thanks.
Thanks for having me to discuss this paper. This is one of those papers that you read it and you just nod along because it all feels right. And to some extent, it feels like things that we already know. But in fact, many of the things we don't know. And in fact, I don't think the authors, they don't, in some ways, they don't give themselves enough credit. There's probably a paragraph in the paper about the data collection, but it's clear there was just an enormous amount of work just to put in this additional piece, which was adding credit spreads to a whole bunch of facts about financial crises that we already know. So I would say, why would you write a paper like this? I would say two reasons. One is that when we find ourselves in a financial crisis, we often ask ourselves the question of how is this going to play out? how bad is it going to be for GDP? How bad is it going to be for firms and raising new capital and so on? So that's kind of one question. And then the second type of question and reason you would write a paper like this is you say, well, maybe we don't really fully understand yet, in spite of all the research that we've done, how crises unfold or whether they're predictable. And maybe adding a new piece of data is actually going to help us do that. And what I would say is that on the first one, I have some comments on that general concept about sort of how good is it, this new piece of data, at helping us forecast things. And then on the second piece, I also want to add a couple of points. I would say, really, I really like the paper. My only kind of critique of the paper is I think it lives too much in this world that Arvind sketched, in which you have this unpredictable shock that kind of arises and hits these levered intermediaries, and then things unfold. And I say that it lives too much in that world because I feel like one of the things the authors could do with the data more is try to understand, you know, to what extent are these crises forecastable, and really think a little bit more on the expectations piece, which is a bit of an afterthought at the end of the paper. So, you know, I would call this crisis research 2.0. You know, the paper starts out with this idea that much of the empirical work that forecasts crises or uses crises to forecast some variable X are basically a bit ad hoc. So, you know, he pointed out the lack of correlation. Where is Arvind? I don't see him. There he is. Arvind pointed out the lack of correlation between these various measures that people have produced of whether there's a financial crisis. So selecting dates in particular involves some judgment. And so here, supplementing data with this impressive information on credit spreads from historical sources could help with this. And I think basically it does. The cross-sectional variation does help. And it helps sort crises ex ante as to which ones are going to be particularly bad, and helps look at the role of expectations. Okay. So yeah, so this is kind of just a graphical way of doing it. So if you think of crises along a spectrum, mostly what these papers do is look at a dummy variable. And I thought a nice kind of empirical add-on was just kind of isolating cross-sectional variation here in the tails, which is really one of the core ideas of the paper. So what's the main regression? I guess he already went through this, is, you know, GDP growth on a crisis dummy interacted with the spread, and this cross-sectional variation in the spread that is useful for forecasting the impact of the crisis. I think one of the things that I would have liked to see here is, you know, running a bit more of horse races compared to traditional crises variables, given that part of the attraction of the paper is sort of adding on this new data. And the other thing I thought was pretty interesting is during garden variety recessions, the credit spread is not a particularly useful forecaster of output. I do think this poses a bit of a puzzle that's a little bit untouched in the paper in terms of the forward-looking nature of the credit spread and what it says. I guess this type of thing would tell you that it's a lot about risk premia rather than a lot of what's happening in crises is risk premia rather than the forward looking information about future defaults. And then table 11 is another interesting table in the paper, which crises turn out badly. Here they regress GDP growth on a dummy for the spread crises, and spread crises interacted with lagged credit growth. The bottom panel just uses credit growth interacted with the spread with very similar results. I would say here, again, a very interesting set of results that kind of confirm our intuition about how financial crises play out. On the other hand, I'm going to come to this in a second, but I would have liked a bit more nuance here. In particular, I think it would have been nice to show, maybe with quantile regression, something like this idea Arvind said but didn't show in the paper, which is that most of the time credit growth is actually probably quite good for GDP growth. It's just occasionally it leads to a financial crisis. And so you're kind of weighing those two things. Okay. So here are my comments on the paper. Number one, I mentioned that one of the objectives of the paper was in thinking, using the credit spread to forecast what happens in the crisis. And one of the troubles with looking at the credit spread or using the credit spread is that in the data, it seems to only react really at the last minute. So it's not really a forecaster in so much. It's a bit like, I kind of like this analogy that it's not an analogy that's original to me, but suppose you wanted to forecast the weather and you look outside and you see people and they've got umbrellas. Well, that's a little late, if you haven't brought your umbrella with you. And so credit spreads do have a bit of this character, which is to say that they start to react only when things get to be pretty bad. In other words, it's a good confirmation that we're in a financial crisis. It's not really very good at, forecasting in the conventional way that we mean forecasting. So I guess more tangibly, here's one particular credit spread. And many of the credit spreads in the last financial crisis behaved in exactly this form. This is the option-adjusted spread on high yield bonds, and you can see here. It's a hard question. Which of these is actually useful? So the paper is using the 1 year sort of they're sort of sampling every single year. But suppose I were a policymaker and I were to ask myself, Arvind was talking about forecasting GDP growth over the next two, three, four years, for example, once you're in a financial crisis. Okay, well, we would agree that we were in a financial crisis here. Is this what I'm using at this point? Am I waiting till here, here, here? This is a pretty large span of time. It's not really very clear. The credit spread is evolving quite a lot over time. If you were just to pick the various points in here and sort of jam them into the regression that Arvind showed, you would actually get this very wide range of estimates about what was going to happen in terms of GDP growth in the US. So it's, in a way, he showed you these pictures where GDP growth is actually using credit spreads is useful for getting closer to the data in the US. I mean, in a way, that's a bit lucky because it depends where you ended up sampling here. Okay, here's a similar picture. Here is, this is unstructured products. So again, it depends what spreads you want to look at. But you can see here, obviously, using the credit spread up until things really started happening wasn't very useful. So they were basically zero. And then, suppose that you said, looking in the credit markets, you could have well made the argument that we were in a financial crisis at the end of 2007. Is that the point at which we start? So a broader message, I think, of these pictures and this discussion is that the authors have the data that they could show some nice if kind of event time pictures of how these things evolve, and they don't do that in the paper. And I think that would also help with the general narrative of how expectations evolve during these crises. So second comment, there's a lot of talk about what the credit spreads add in terms of value add relative to what we know. And I think that's basically right for many of the facts. I think one of the places where I struggled with that is whether the results in the paper that use both credit spreads and credit growth are adding much relative to what we already knew about credit growth. So Gary made a very similar comment. I think you said there are 20-odd papers or 30-odd papers that show the relationship between credit growth and the depth, for example, the depth of recessions following financial crises. The paper doesn't really show in any way that it's the credit spread versus the financial crisis indicator interacted with credit growth that is really giving us a lot of that action. So I would say, again, just kind of along the lines of, part of the argument of doing this kind of work is that you're going to get enhanced explanatory power would be to run some of these horse races and to really show. So I would say that would be a useful thing to quantify in the paper, sort of, first of all, in showing that, and then second of all, kind of in an R-squared sense. There isn't ever sort of kind of an R-squared discussion in the paper. And oftentimes, again, we're just trying to get better forecasting models when we find ourselves in this situation. Okay? My last comment is, look, I basically buy this narrative of when we have a shock and it interacts with leverage, that's going to tell us a lot about how the crisis is going to play out. I think the paper could be more ambitious in trying to understand where that shock comes from and using some of their data to get there. Now, the paper does do some of this. So Arvind showed at the very end of the presentation, showed some of that. But I think it's a bit, to me, it feels like a bit of an add-on relative to me, what's the kind of one of the central questions that actually is unanswered when we think about the narrative of financial crises. Okay, so the paper's perspective on expectations is basically that the crisis itself is not very forecastable, but high credit growth before the event, before the financial crisis, leads to fragility, so that if the crisis unfolds, credit spreads quickly change. And here, this is this famous Hemingway quote, you know, it occurs at first very slowly, then all at once, you know, you have the leverage in the system and boom, it explodes. So I would have liked help in separately unpacking sort of the two components. Number one, the forecastability of the crisis itself. So is the so-called surprise predictable? And the fragility of the crisis. The way it's framed and the way that Arvind framed it was, well, the fragility goes up and that's not accounted for in the credit spreads. But I think we know from a lot of other work, whether it's Barone and Zhang, some work that I've done with Sam Hansen, some of the Shularik and Taylor, that at least to some extent the crisis itself is forecastable. So it's really the combination of these two things. It seems like you could quantify how much is coming from one versus the other. It's a very natural exercise. So Jeremy Stein with Lopez Salido and Zakracek, they have a paper that ends up with a very different message. So I think it's worth spending a bit of time in the paper, in your paper, and confronting it. They sort of claim that it's the forecastability of credit spreads rather than kind of capturing fragility that's driving the forecasting ability of GDP, at least in the US. You have this much larger sample, so you could reject that claim more broadly, or you could ask why you disagree with them. So my preferred crisis narrative, and I'm just wondering whether the authors can reject this, is that periods of credit growth are driven by investor optimism, extrapolation of GDP growth, past default rates, and so on. One result is a misallocation of credit. We know higher credit growth forecasts low returns on average, which would be a natural corollary of this. And then, of course, in some particularly severe incidents, the losses end up affecting levered financial institutions, which have grown their balance sheets and leverage during this time, resulting in the crisis. So I wonder whether the paper could reject this narrative. I'm not sure. The way that they tackle expectations in the paper, to me, is a bit odd. He runs these regressions where he's running credit spreads on a bunch of variables through time t. To me, the natural way to tackle expectations would be to run kind of a forecasting regression. And then at least if you start with the benchmark of constant expected returns, to the extent that you're capturing forecastability, that would tell you something about too low or too high. Or to put it differently, when you say that credit spreads are too high or too low, it's always, you have to ask the question, relative to what? And so I don't think that's particularly clear. Okay, so let me just stop there. Again, I think it's a very interesting paper. I think there's quite a bit more they can do with the data. I'm not sure they want to do it here or elsewhere, but I think there's opportunity given the data set to dig into some of the sort of still kind of big questions. And to me, just to review, those questions are, number one, you know, what the calm before the storm, this period of calm, the role of expectations in driving the crisis in the first place. And then lastly, let me just mention this, all of these papers that look at credit growth rather than credit levels. And that's something that I haven't really seen addressed in the literature.
Thanks.